idea, but I can close it now, but for any stragglers. I'm usually a straggler, and I appreciate the tourism. welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for coming out. This is going to be a great talk, and Polar the dog is going to eat your pizza if you put it down. Just FYI. He's very friendly. Yes, I'm Cassie. I'm the ED of WEN, and we are so excited to have two really great women here tonight to make you beautiful tea, and my gift is less beautiful than pizza, but we're just really excited to have our former executive director, Julie, back for a talk as well. Charity. We focus on the intersection of women's health and environmental health, two poorly researched fields that need a lot more attention and a lot more advocacy, and that's our job, is to educate one another and to take action on issues that matter to our health. We're very lucky to have one of our co-founders here tonight, Dorothy Golden Rosenberg, who I'm spotlighting with pizza. Sorry about that, Dorothy. So thank you so much for coming out. We'll just do a quick go round. Maybe we'll start here. It's okay. Just tell me your name and tell me a little bit about what you do and how you do today.
My name's Amanda Yeager, and I'm also almost a naturopathic doctor. Becoming licensed, so I know them through that, and just interested in women's health and the environment.
My name is Emma Roman. I have spoken at WEN events before, too. I am a green living consultant, for lack of a better term, so I help families reduce toxics at home. And environmental health and women's health is very important to me.
My name is Sunny Sanait, and I worked with the women in the Women's Health Organization for many, many years. And in the last couple of years, I decided to do my own independent consulting, and I work with one-on-one and groups as well of women with cancer. And I talk a lot about environment as well, all aspects of women's health. And when I heard about environment, I got to come and learn some stuff.
I'm Julie. Y'all know me. You read the thing, so that's why I'm here.
And I'm Tanya. Same.
Yeah. We're all naturopathic doctors, by the way, so you should.
My name is Safada. Nowadays, I'm an independent consultant for small and major organizations developing new ideas and business, and hopefully some business and projects around social impact and sustainability. And I'm also a new board member of the WEN for the last month. It's very recently.
I'm Stephanie Papp. I went to school for public health at university and spent some time in South Africa working with refugees and got very disillusioned in public health. And decided to restart a girls' sexual health program down there. So kind of 10 years later, coming back to public health. So that's my heart project, and my new other project is I'm a consultant as well. I work with small business founders and entrepreneurs to help them set up their business processes and their administrative teams.
Good. Well, so good to hear who everybody is. So I'm Dorothy Golden Rosenberg, and I'm a founding member of WEN. Way back, 20 years ago or something.
25.
And we founded the organization because there was a real need for women's health and the environment You know, there were many environmental groups and there were many health groups, but there was no women, health, and the environment together. And Liz Armstrong went down to a conference in Texas, and with Bella Abzug, and a whole bunch of people, and she came back, and we found her when? Somebody knocking on the door? And we founded the group, and well, one of the important things, and I was just talking about the film Exposure, Environmental Links of Breast Cancer. One of the things that came out of, I was doing my PhD at Boise at the time, and I was looking at research related to breast cancer, women's health and the environment, cancer prevention, and it just seemed, I'm a film person from way back, and it just seemed to some of us that we had to have a film. And so we got together, found some people, we organized the film, we fundraised for 3 years, 4 years, and the film won a lot of awards. So if those of you who are here haven't seen it, I'm sure that it's very easy to see it. And it's narrated by Olivia Dujon, who's a breast cancer survivor, but who last year was recently, I don't know if it was, it wasn't breast cancer, it was in another part of the body, so they don't know if it's a metastasis or if it was whatever, I knew. But anyway, but she's narrating the film, and she's saying she did all the right things, and so she wondered why she got breast cancer. So, but it's such a phenomenon, and it's an epidemic, you know, breast cancer is an epidemic. And it's, the film is still valid, the science, the people, the issues, the radiation, the endocrine disruptors, people weren't talking about those things then. So, but anyway, for those of you who aren't here who want to see it, have a look at it and see where you could show it yourselves in your own communities, because it's a good teaching tool. And it comes with a booklet full of information. That's who I am. I'm also a grandmother of three grown young women now. And I'll tell you that looking at the young people growing up now, it's really, really important because they are exposed to stuff even more than I was or you were, because there's more stuff everywhere. They're all university now, and I look ahead. And another film that we distributed is called Toxic Trespasses on Children's in the Environment. It's a National Film Board co-production, and it's about children and health and the environment. So lots of good resources to draw on here.
Thank you. Hi everyone, my name is Benedict. I'm not a naturopath. I work for sustainability and corporate responsibility rating agency. And I'm just very interested in living a more sustainable life and a more healthy life. And I really like where it is.
Hi, my name is Marie. I'm a change management consultant, so my work has nothing to do with this. It's more on the personal side. For me, it started with zero waste. And the thing is just that I put healthier options first before zero waste options. So that's kind of why I'm here. When you can have both, it's amazing, but healthy first.
Hi, I'm Anita. I've been a volunteer on the board member with WAN for a couple of years.
Thank goodness.
About a decade.
Maybe a decade. Maybe I'm watching it for you. Women's health has always been dear to my heart. I always wanted to educate more people and have change in that sphere. So that's why I tried to with WAN. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Kay. I am a volunteer with WEN, and I also work at a health charity, managing the research programs, Crohn's and Colitis Canada. And I'm just very interested in women's health and the environment.
Hi, my name is Katina Collins. I studied contaminant movement in the environment, and especially got really inspired by my undergrad thesis, which was in the movement of organic chlorides to the north. Sorry. So really have since then been really super interested in health, especially as it pertains to the environment and what we're dealing with every day. I've worked in energy conservation, I've worked in remediation, I've worked in diversion of mercury from the landfills, and now I'm on the flip side, I'm working for the Canadian Cancer Society, running a national smoking cessation project for them.
A national what?
Smoking cessation project.
Oh, smoking.
So trying to figure out, you know, is there a movement towards the prevention side, they're not there yet, but there's always hope. and so I've always been super interested, and I'm also a recent new member of the board.
Well, thank you all for being here.
and I'm happy to introduce our speakers more formally. We're very excited to have Dr. Julie Wong, who is also an executive officer of the Institute of Green and Open Sciences, is the Canadian ambassador to the International Congress on Naturopathic Medicine. She studied and trained at McGill University and CCNM, where she was awarded scholarships for excellence in her naturopathic medicine as she pursued additional training at the Humlegarden.
Danish. You're great.
In Denmark, and has done research in epilepsy with the University of Toronto Epilepsy Research Program. Her continuing education includes the fields of psychology, environmental medicine, consciousness and healing, learning from teachers and leaders around the world. She is co-founder of Aura Medicine and Wellness Clinic and practices in downtown Toronto. Welcome, Julie, and your esteemed colleague, is a co-founder of Aura Medicine Clinic. Dr. Tavar completed her undergraduate studies in political science and journalism at Concordia University, and subsequently worked as a writer, editor, and facilitator. She practiced naturopathic medicine in Sheffield, UK, 1 year, and then returned to Toronto to continue building her practice. Over the years, she's developed a special interest in hormonal health, mental health, and autoimmune conditions. Dr. Tavar is passionate about connecting medicine and health to the broader social, cultural, and political context of each patient's life. And just as a side note for our talk, there will be an opportunity to ask questions of the speakers after the talk during networking. So please hold your questions till the end. And welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Cassie. And thank you, everyone, for coming. Please help yourselves to tea at any point in pizza. It's Tulsi Lavender, so it's not caffeinated, and it's very good. If you happen to leave early, please put your email down, because we have a booklet that we'll be giving away, which is like a summary of the talk. And so if you want a copy, just put your email down. And we'll just start with a breathing exercise. So get comfy, lean back in your chair, have 2 feet on the ground if you'd like, and close your eyes. So lay back in the chair and place one or both hands on your lower stomach or abdomen. And breathe slowly through your nose. And feel your abdomen rise as you breathe in. And your upper chest should remain still and relaxed. And then breathe out slowly through your mouth. So breathe in and let your abdomen expand through your nose. And then you can breathe out through your mouth. And let your abdomen move towards your spine. And you can feel your feet ground into the earth. And just be with your breath for a few more minutes.
what we want to talk about today. We'll start with our learning objectives, and we wanted to keep it pretty simple. So we want to talk about three things. So first, we want to talk about, we're going to talk about why. So why even have this talk? As you know, one has a lot of talks. There's many talks out there, but why this talk about the body and how it interacts with the environment? Well, the second thing we'll talk about is how. So really, how does our body respond to what's going on in the world around us? Then the last thing we're gonna address is really what. So in addition to what's going on inside the body, really, what is it that we can do to benefit our body and practical tools, so you're not just intellectualizing all day. So let's start with why. Why do we need to talk about the body? So it's really funny because when we talk about environmental health, a lot of times we talk about like what's out there. You know, all the stuff out there that we should be looking out for, right? And that's very important, actually. And that's actually, you know, a critical component of environmental health, the environment. Trying to control external factors that can impact our health and our safety, it's very important, and the work of many of our counterparts, Emma's work, a lot of your work in here is around that. So we believe that learning about what's in here is really what can help us feel a sense of empowerment as we navigate through the changing and multiple stimuli of our environments. Okay? So that's why, that's really why we wanted to start with by talking about the body and bringing it back in. Also, it's kind of what we do. So when we see people on a day-to-day basis, one-on-one, in consult, you know, in our patient visits, we often, that's what we are talking about more, is like what's happening in your body. And so talking about that, we thought, hey, this is something that everybody can learn and maybe benefit from. That's why. So the second thing is that we'll move on to is how. So how does our body respond to anything out there? So can you name some things that you would say stress you out? What kind of things stress you out?
Clutter.
Clutter. Okay. Stop.
Silly TPC rise.
Okay. TPC.
Public turning.
Uncontrollable.
Age appropriate public turning.
So responsibilities at home. Parenting.
You could just say children.
Family general.
Family. Family. That's what you said, right?
I did. I was saying children, so I'm thinking about my siblings and cousins and
all that. Yeah. The ish.
Extended, yes.
Okay, very good. What else?
Sound and noise.
Yeah. What about work or your inbox, emails.
Phones.
Emails, calls, phones. Okay, very good. Anything else? You get the idea. There's many things out there. So, okay, there's multiple things. Let's talk a little bit. These are eyes. This is Leslie. So, I had a patient, Leslie. They came in to see me for pain, chronic pain, fibromyalgia. And they have a number of symptoms. So, I'll just write down the symptoms real quick, or I'll just mention them and then we'll get to it. So, one of the symptoms is anxiety palpitations. palpitations a lot, so they feel their heartbeat. Heartburn, acne, muscle tension, primary chief concern was muscle tension or pain, and insomnia. So difficulty falling asleep, and occasionally would wake up in the middle of the night and have to go pee, usually around 3 to 5 a.m. So those are the general symptoms. Now we're just going to talk about what's going on in the body. So we see all these things, and let me put this over here. You'll remember the last one. So what happens is that we have these triggers. Okay, these are, where is stress? Stress is not happening out there. These are just triggers. They're stimuli, things that are happening around us. We can't control them. So, or we have less control of them, right? They just happen. And you might be sitting in your office place next to your colleague and you're experiencing the same environmental situation, the same physical space. You might have totally different reactions. One of you might get headaches. The other one might get, you know, shortness of breath, anxiety, and might get a rash, eczema, something like that. Okay, so people have different reactions to stress. So we're going to talk a little more about what's going on inside the body, this part. So in general, we have this trigger or stimuli, and that it triggers something in the body called the autonomic nervous system. Who here knows of this? Has heard of it? Yes, see? Amazing. So we all know this. It's very good. So the autonomic nervous system has two components. There's the parasympathetic nervous system. Who knows what that is? The breakdown of, okay, so colloquially we call it the rest and digest function. Rest and digest. And then we have the sympathetic nervous system. I'm sorry, Ethan, I'm blocking you. But you know, that's okay. Perfect. That's actually really helpful. Okay, and this one is the ever famous, that's great, thank you so much. This is the ever famous fight or flight response. Yeah, everyone's heard of this one. Fight or flight. Very good. So let's break that down further though. So something happens out there, get an email or 500 emails, and then your body has this response. Right? Historically what happened was, I mean, people talk about this and it's kind of theoretical, is that we have hunger or famine, and so our body needs to survive. We go into sympathetic mode, fight or flight mode, we need to survive, we need to eat. Ourselves. But maybe we haven't eaten in a few days, right? Hunter-gatherer days. This is the theory. So hunter-gatherer days, we're out there, we need to hunt. So what happens? Okay, our body is going to process that stimulant, that cerebral understanding of hunger or thirst, or they're going to see something. Say there's like a tiger in the room, right? Or an antelope to hunt or something like that. So they see something, and then cerebrally, there's a message that's sent from the nervous, in subconsciously in the nervous system. So that's an autonomic nervous response. You can't. The question is it conscious or is it subconscious, right? In a theoretical sense. But anyway, you're not thinking about it. You can't voluntarily make your heart, you know, beat. So the body system is there to help you survive. What it does is it sends a message to your your endocrine glands, thyroid, adrenal glands. I mean, we're simplifying here, so thank you for understanding if you're a science major. but sends a message, and then at the adrenal level, so the adrenal glands, they sit right on top of the kidneys. There's two parts to it. There's the medulla. That part releases adrenalines, or epinephrine and norepinephrine. And then there's the cortex, and that's going to release cortisol. So we'll talk about the epinephrine. What happens is the adrenal glands release the epinephrine, and everyone knows about epinephrine a little, right? So it makes your heart beat so that you can get blood pumping to your muscles so you can get going, run away from the tiger. run towards the antelope. Additionally, that epinephrine, there are receptors that make it shunt the blood flow from your digestive organs towards your muscles. So the blood flow changes and it starts to move in the direction where it's needed, the muscles, because the muscles need that blood in order to fight or flight or run. And then secondly, that cortex. Okay, so the cortex of the adrenal gland, super small gland sits on top of the kidney, cortex releases cortisol. Everyone's heard of cortisol, the famous stress hormone. So when the cortisol is released in your brain, it liberates blood glucose. It tells the liver, release blood glucose up it in the bloodstream so that it's available there for your muscles to absorb it. It also releases or stimulates the upregulation of insulin receptors in the muscles so that it can absorb that blood glucose into the muscles. Okay, does that kind of driving with everyone? So that's what happens in red alert. But then, historically, we would eat, and then the stress stimuli of hunger would go away. Today, we eat, we feed ourselves, we try to relax, but then, ride the TTC. I'm from. Right.
Me too.
Right. It's just kind of, you know, unpredictable. You know, or you still have noisy neighbors. You still have, you know, 498. Right. So you still have the stimuli. And it's not turning off. The classic negative feedback loop is broken. What else? So what's happening is the blood flow is going to the muscles. Where is it coming from? So there needs to be a vasoconstriction aspect. So let's talk a little bit about the parasympathetic nervous system. The rest and digest function. This is the opposite nervous system, autonomic response. It helps us rest, sleep well, helps us digest. So, invariably, the blood flow then would go to the stomach, the digestive organs, stimulates the gallbladder to produce bile, to produce digestive enzymes, release the stuff from the pancreas, get you know, able to digest the fats that you're eating, that kind of thing. Also, it liberates blood flow in that area because it turns off the adrenal glands from producing that epinephrine. So it brings the blood flow to that's one thing. Then, secondly, the rest aspect. So it's turning off the stimulation of the adrenal glands, and cortisol should be cycling normally. The ideal, this is the, like, some, we'll get a bit into the testing if you want to. We can always talk about that. But sometimes we talk about cortisol dysregulation. So ideally, when you're waking up in the morning, when you're with my patient, insomnia, difficulty falling asleep, would wake up in the middle of the night, and then wakes up, has to get to work, wakes up around 7:30, exhausted. Energy level 3/10 at most, 10 being the most. And very wakes up dragging, you know, pressing the snooze button, that kind of thing. And so what we talk about is that cortisol should be cycling through the body, highest in the morning, 4 times throughout the day. And go up, down, up, down. And sometimes we get a lot of the dips. The adrenal glands, then what's happening is that the adrenal glands are producing cortisol constantly, but we're not responding to it, right? So the system is on overload, the sympathetic nervous system, or fight or flight all day. Parasympathetic nervous system turns that off, and ideally then the body can recuperate and rest. So this is the response to the stimuli. We'll get a bit deeper into it. But the important one I want to focus on is the digestion. So when, you know, I have this patient, she has low motility in the gut, so getting a bit of constipation as well, or some alternating constipation, loose stools, sometimes diarrhea. That kind of picture is what people would call like IBS, right, that kind of thing, irritable bowel syndrome. Has anyone encountered that? Yeah, so, but that's just a syndrome. That's a collection of symptoms, right? It's not a diagnostic. It's not actually understanding the process that's happening or honoring that. What ends up happening, though, that develops towards that is that because of that decreased blood flow, because of the low attention and the low motility, there's low peristalsis action, and then there's an increase of an inflammatory response within the gut lining, because you can have a buildup of toxicants that doesn't move through the system. So this is our one of the primary elimination channels in the body, the gut. Yeah. That's why everyone looks at your poop. For us, it's very important for us to know the qualities of your bowels, and that's a major question. Secondly, part of that is going to tie into the liver. So a lot of people talk about detox, and we're going to get more into that. Tanya will elaborate further. But that's why, because when the liver eliminates anything as its job, then it needs to put it somewhere. So it's going to put it in the gut. When it doesn't go through the gut, then it has three other detoxification organs to go to, and Tanya will tell you more about that. The last thing I'll mention is that there's a decrease in the immune system here in the digestive system. And so that's because you've heard of probiotics. So the commensal bacteria, and this is like last decade or so of research, they're starting to do more research on this. So the microbiome, which exists in the gut, is what determines the immune system. And how reactive it is. So when you see things like, and this patient also had, I don't know if I mentioned, but also had a little bit of eczema and seasonal allergies. So when you get that sort of hyper-reactivity of the immune system, it's related to the digestion and the inflammatory process. I don't want to get too into it, but that's kind of the gist of how things are tied into each other. So in environmental medicine, we talk about the accumulation of toxicants in the body, the digestive system being the primary source of elimination. If that's blocked, we have other organs of detoxification. So I'll leave it to Tanya to sort of elaborate further on that.
Thanks,
Julie.
That was great.
So since this talk is centered around our health and the world around us, I'm going to talk about how to let go of what we take in. And one of the names that we can refer to in this process is detoxification. And so I'll start with some definitions: detoxification, toxins, and then I'll go through the organs of detox and how to support each one. So my approach in general as a naturopathic doctor is quite gentle, and I like to make sustainable changes. So these suggestions that I'll tell you according to each organ are pretty, they might sound basic or simple, but they're actually foundational to preventive health. So you can think about it when I mention each organ. You can think about, you know, if this is an organ that you might need to support in your own health. So I'm going to talk about detoxification, and within the resources that we'll provide, there will be something like a fast, maybe not what in the traditional sense, what you may imagine a fast to be like, but you'll see it. I'll talk about it more, and then you'll see it in the handout. So why now? Why detox now? So spring's a time of year when the weather is getting warmer, we're moving, our energy levels becoming higher, we're becoming more active, we're kind of moving out of that very insular, slow time that winter kind of allows us to be, or doesn't, but maybe should. So winter is traditionally a time of slowing down, eating more heavy, fatty, salty foods, and some of our ancestors may have naturally fasted during this time of year because resources were scarce and, you know, fresh food wasn't yet ready to be harvested. So it's common, like, in the world we live in, you know, we kind of want quick results, everything's fast-paced, so it's common to think about fasting as something that's short-term, momentary, intense, extreme, like, you know, perhaps a juice fast. But I generally, in my experience working with patients in a longer term way, people benefit from slower, milder fasts, which focus on whole foods and essentially fostering a consciousness of patience and connection with the wisdom and the gentle cycles of our health and the environment around us. So, what is a toxin? So simply put, it's something in our body that should not be there, potentially at the level of creating symptoms or disease. And even more simply put, it's something that is not serving us. So we're all exposed to toxins, and our bodies have a way of dealing with these toxins naturally. But given the current environment, and you all know, well, I mean, many of you know more about this than I do, but given the current increase in toxins in our environment, it's building up more and more, and our cup is getting full and fuller, and this is one of the reasons we become more sensitive to external factors and like food and, you know, products and the environmental allergens like plants and pollen. So because our cup is full, our body's not able to deal with this excess, and we start getting these symptoms and feeling unwell. So supporting the process of detoxification allows us to lessen this burden and, you know, take a little bit of water out of the cup and allows us to function more optimally. And what is detoxification? So in toxicology, it means one toxin that has burdened your body, and one treatment, or perhaps multiple treatments, but usually one treatment that is used to get rid of that toxin. The more accurate term for detoxification, the way we actually know it, is depuration. And that's enhancing the body's natural process of waste removal. And that's what we'll talk about today. But just for simplicity's sake, I'm going to say detoxification, but now you kind of have some clarity around the definitions. So a couple ways we eliminate toxins. We either neutralize them, so our bodies neutralize them, essentially making them ineffective, and then we excrete them, so we let them go, which is what we're trying to do. So the five organs of elimination or detoxification, can we name them? Julie mentioned one, or Julie mentioned a couple. Filters our blood, it produces bile. in fads. And then the liver does something which is kind of cool, which is it has this process of phase one and phase two detoxification, which go hand in hand. And you may have heard about this before, supporting your liver, dandelion, milk thistle. So phase one, to simplify it, phase one modifies the toxin for phase two, and then phase two neutralizes it, making it ineffective so that it can be eliminated. In this process, phase one releases free radicals, which we have commonly understood to be contributors in cancer, among other conditions. But phase two deals with those free radicals, so it neutralizes them just as it neutralizes other toxins. So you kind of want to have this balance of phase one and phase two. If phase one is more active than phase two, then your body's making free radicals and we don't really want that. And then the cool part is coming now, which is that curcumin, which is the compound in turmeric that makes it yellow, actually slows down phase one and increases phase two so that your body is increasing the way to deal with the free radicals, so you're not having that free radical buildup. So just to show how like these simple kind of herbs and foods can do so much. The brassica family plants like broccoli, cabbage, and cauliflower also increase phase two, so they increase your body's response to free radicals. And Cassie, shout out to the pizza with the broccoli.
We're starting right now.
So that's one of the reasons why turmeric is an anti-inflammatory and an antioxidant. So a couple suggestions for liver support, increase that family of vegetables. You can throw a pinch of turmeric or two in your smoothies and your salads. And then another treatment that naturopaths commonly use is castor oil. So castor oils from the castor bean plant. You may know depending on your background, you may have had to take it as a child. But we use it topically in our treatments. So we put it, and this is also in the resource handout, so you can apply it on your liver, which is right here, right side. And it helps stimulate circulation, it helps with inflammation.
Are you saying you apply it on your skin over here?
Yeah.
Correct.
Oh.
Yeah, so it's like a sticky liquid, and you apply it, and then
stains.
You apply heat to increase the circulation, and that stimulates the liver to work optimally.
So why did we always have to eat it?
We're not allowed to prescribe it internally.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That and cod liver, I never wanted it. And now we're taking fish oil.
Yeah.
People take castor oil to get going.
Prunes will do it.
Probably tastier.
Yeah. No, it's okay.
Can I ask
a question?
Sure.
So we're actually going to keep all the questions till the end.
Okay.
Yeah,
great.
Sorry,
interrupt. So just a suggestion, if we have someone with hormonal concerns coming into our practice, like menstrual pain, irregularities, heavy bleeding, one of the first steps to take is to start with the liver, because the liver processes our hormones. So it's kind of like you can start there, and you can even start with a castor oil pack and see, you know, that might shift something. It might not change everything, but you know, it's a start to kind of get things moving. So the second organ are the kidneys. So the kidneys are the filters of our bodies, and eliminate waste via the urine. And the kidneys can be supported by minimizing things like coffee, alcohol, soda, sweetened beverages, and replacing them with water, herbal teas, and lemon water. So one of the things I suggest to people, to my patients, is set an alarm in your phone, like every hour, every 2 hours, to drink more water. Or with any beverage, like with any coffee, with any tea, or even a soda or a juice, drink 2 glasses of water. So say you have a cup of coffee in the morning, you have a cup of tea in the morning, 2 glasses of water with that tea.
Well, the tea helps you go too.
Yeah.
Yeah. The caffeine impacts it.
And then Julie talked quite a bit about the digestive tract. So I'll speak about it from another perspective. So the liver makes bile, and bile helps, as I mentioned earlier, helps us digest fats. And it also serves as a carrier to let toxins out of our body. And it binds to the toxins. It's in the intestines, and then it's either, if we have enough fiber and water, it's excreted in our bowel movements, or it's recycled. So what we want is, when we're trying to get rid of the toxins, we want it to be excreted. So so here we can see the importance of, like what Julie mentioned, regular bowel movements and looking at our poo and talking about our poo. So if you have, say, constipation, maybe supporting the digestive tract can be beneficial. And a very gentle way to do this is to increase fiber and water. So back to like the strategies of how to increase your water intake. And then if there's no change with these two interventions, then you might want to consider seeing someone one-on-one, but it's definitely a good start and can go a long way. So whole grains, fruits, vegetables, legumes, all great sources of fiber. The other organ is skin. So our toxins are excreted through sweat, and sweating is actually one of the best ways to get rid of toxins. And there was this study, Stephen Jennings, I don't know if anyone knows who he is, I don't, but I referenced his study because it was really good, about how sweating can actually get rid of most toxins, like more than any other organ of elimination. So saunas, regular saunas, exercise, and so it's important to make use of this organ. And it can also go back to like supporting hormonal health, because again, you're like, often I'll work with people with thyroid conditions, and one of my recommendations is like to do regular saunas, and that could even be like once a month. So going back to the start of our talk, back to the exercise that we did, we'll look at the lungs. So the lungs takes in oxygen, eliminates CO2, and this process plays a major role in our body's optimal performance in general, including the brain, digestive tract, immune system. So back to kind of like this whole process here, where there's the trigger, the stimuli, the fight or flight. So I ask you, next time you're in this situation, to kind of step back and do that breathing that we did at the start of the class. And sometimes being aware of your breath throughout the day can change like the outcome of your day by the end of it, impacting things like sleep and the way you feel the next day. So So really like connecting with your breath and learning when you're not breathing deep enough and taking that time to like sit back and step back from whatever situation you're in and do that exercise. And you can even do it like with your eyes open. So as naturopathic doctors, we look at the connection, the interconnection. We don't only look at the body, we look at the interconnection between the mind, the body, the spirit, and the emotion. And Dorothy?
Yes.
When you mentioned that the person who narrated that film,
Olivia
Newton-John, and she said that she did everything right, I welcome you all to read this book. Maybe you know about it, maybe you've read it, by Gabor Mate, When the Body Says No, because it brings in the emotional, the mental emotional element of like health concerns. And so detoxification can also be letting go mentally and emotionally. So some questions to kind of think to yourself is there something that's toxic in my life or someone that I can let go of? So I'm just gonna quickly go through the organs again and just mention and talk about some questions that, you know, you can ask yourself in regards to each organ based on the mental emotional connection. And one kind of side note I wanted to share is that there's some nice research that suggests that, and it makes this connection even more clear, is that we actually have inflammatory components in our tears. So when we hold back from crying, we're holding back from the potential expression of certain inflammatory toxins in the body. Cry it out.
Because research.
Cry it out. So, just going back to the organs. So the liver. The liver in traditional Chinese medicine loves to tell other organs what to do. It loves activity. And when it's not being nourished, it can get stagnant and slowed down. So it's a very action-oriented organ. So one of the questions you can ask yourself if you feel like you're leaning towards like maybe liver imbalance is what needs action in my life? Digestion. So if you have maybe concerns with constipation, one of the questions you can ask is what do I need to let go of? What am I not letting go of? The kidneys in traditional Chinese medicine are all about fear. And some of the questions that I ask my patients to do if I see like a kidney imbalance is do one thing this week that scares you. Or ask yourself what really creates the fear in your life. And then the lungs. In Chinese medicine, traditional Chinese medicine, are connected to grief. And that's why I really like to do the focus on deep breathing and work with my patients with that, because there's a lot of grief that we carry. And so one of the things you can do is focus the deep breathing, be outdoors, and ask yourself, what or who have I lost in my life that I haven't let go of? And then lastly, the skin. The skin is your barrier to the outside world. So it's kind of like your boundaries. So one of the questions you can ask yourself if you have skin concerns is, am I doing more for others than I can right now? So that's the summary of the organs. And with the resource that we'll give you, you'll see that there's a section on a suggested fast, and it's quite simple. It's a whole foods fast, and it the time recommendations are different. You can do it like for 3 to 14 days. You can do it 3 days per month. And I think there was another suggested time period. But I just wanted to add that at the end of the day, it's important because it is a standardized resource just to know yourself. So if you run hot, you might want to avoid cold, or you might like to have cold foods, but if you run very cold, you know, you might not want to have, you might want to have more cooked foods, more warming foods. So even though, you know, it's a guideline just to kind of work from, and the most important thing is to know, like to look inwards and see how you feel. And a couple other, just to mention a couple other parts of the handout. So there's a recipe on dandelion leaf, like a dandelion leaf dish. So dandelion leaf is a bitter herb and it helps stimulate digestion, which we've kind of phased out of our diets. We've phased out like the bitter taste. So it's nice to bring it back in. And then burdock is a root. It's a very neutral tea. It's an herb. It's quite neutral. It's very nourishing. It supports the liver, the lymph, the digestion. And I haven't seen, it's generally good for most people. You can't always say everyone, but it's quite a supportive herb. And just bringing it back to spring as I close up, it's a time for new beginnings. So even if you don't want to change anything in your diet, you can do something like a fast or a break from electronics, where you turn off your electronics at 7 or 9 p.m. every night, or whatever works for you. Or you can start a new exercise routine. You know, it's the time of activity. Clear out the old patterns that don't serve you anymore and connect with nature. And clear out the clutter in your heart and your mind that you're hanging on to. That's it for me.
Love the Chinese medicine aspects, and we can always talk more about it one-on-one, but Chinese medicine has a depth of understanding. Their organ systems are not the same as our organ systems, but there are the emotional qualities that are attached to specific, you know, patterns, yeah, human patterns in terms of conditions. So that was very helpful. So in order to remember some of the things we talked about, as Tanya mentioned, we put together a guide, mostly around the detox aspects, depurification.
Yeah.
And in this booklet, we've included sort of a summary of what you had today, some recipes. If you want a copy, just leave your email, and we'll email it to you. We don't want to print a bunch. And then we also wanted to offer you something else, just on behalf of Orem. So since you've taken the time and the effort to sort of attend this talk, to learn about your bodies, things you probably already know, but you know, to work with us today and to support WEN, which, you know, is a wonderful organization, then we decided that our 90-minute initial appointments are normally $200, but we wanted to just offer it for free to those of you who attended. If you wanted to, it's a one-on-one session, and in this, that way we could explore more personally if you wanted specific ways to support your health, just based on your individual needs, because we can't really give medical advice otherwise. And if you're interested in that, just feel free to check the box off and we'll email you more information on the email list on your way up. But yeah, we'll open it up to any questions and pizza. we're pizza friendly, as we were telling us. Yeah, so.
And with broccoli, it's practically healthy.
Yeah. Less fear, more safety.
thank you so much, and yeah, we hope you found it helpful.
Thank you so much. That was great.
Talks about meditation a lot these days, and about developing mindfulness practices and things like yoga, things like that. In terms of little things, my thing is usually around food. So if we're eating or we're drinking, I usually suggest to my patients, especially if they're starting out, don't have like a, you know, don't go to yoga or whatever once a week, then I think it's very useful to say, okay, when you're eating your food, try to turn your phone over, put on silent, and not work when you're eating. And then I say, count your chews. So we want to aim for 30 chews before you swallow, like chewing. Celebrate at 5. Okay? You give yourself a huge pat on the back, and then you take another bite of food. But yeah, that really, that brief moment of non-judgment and also allowing, I think like we get in caught up in this rightness and wrongness and, you know, self-judgment, self-deprecation aspects and, you know, toxic thinking. But it's okay, you know, we're all human and we're trying to develop our practices, and there's so many resources out there that I can't speak on all of them. But that's a little thing that I use sometimes.
I have a new one that I started using, which is to lay in the dark for 5 to 10 minutes. So it's just like if you're at work and you have the space to go kind of lay in the dark on your back on the floor or after work to break up the intensity of like doing. Your thing and then go to a quiet room and just lay down on your back and that's it. Sometimes think through the day, like there's, you know, you may want to like go through the events of your day and then kind of try and let go of them. It's not exactly like what maybe you were asking, but that's something I've been doing, suggesting.
Yeah, just little tricks to turn on that person.
But you've got a kid at home that will want you when you get home. You're not going to go lie down in the dark.
Maybe we should both lie down in the dark.
There's an answer.
That's right. That's right. A little, I like it. I like this whole vision. Just sterilize it too. We were told. So.
Yeah. You can put that on us.
That's right.
Yeah.
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 Doctor's orders. Any other thoughts or questions? That was really great.
Sorry, thank you for interrupting me, because I would have gone on. My question is around having supplements versus whole foods. Mm-hmm. Like I juice, I somehow fantastically managed to do one thing right. I juice every morning, and I do juice turmeric. But I'm wondering, should I be taking them in capsules instead? Am I not getting enough of a concentrated dose? I have like maybe like an inch of turmeric root, fresh turmeric.
Mm-hmm.
But is it better in general for dandelion or whatever it is to have either the whole food or kind of having concentrated dose?
even if you didn't, you're still doing great. Supplements, okay, so I like to do a cost-benefit analysis because there's usually a number of factors. Access to certain foods, content, nutrient content, absorbability. So if we're talking about a big one that I talk about, like one of the few things I supplement sometimes is a magnesium. So magnesium content in our plants, vegetables, what we have is quite low in the soil. The soil content doesn't actually allow for a ton of magnesium to come into the foods. And this has been studied, I think, in some of the studies on organic foods. So that, for example, is something that if you were to take a food form, the best food form would be one avocado is about 250 milligrams of magnesium. Okay, whole food, wonderful. An avocado in this part of the world costs about $4. Okay, $2. Really? The organic one at the Flora Fruit Market was $1.99.
Karma Co-op
is amazing. I'm actually going there. So, but definitely, so you see what I mean? It's 250 milligrams for $1.50. Right? You're looking at the capsule, can prep, and you can get a concentrated magnesium dosage. But you also get the extract of the most absorbable form. You can get this glycinate, which is a chelated form, and it's the most absorbable. And it's studied for a multitude of things. So sleep, muscle, relaxation, that kind of. So the second thing that I didn't mention is also outcome. What are you looking to accomplish? If you're looking to gently depurify the body and support your general detoxification, I think whole foods are absolutely wonderful and essential. If you're looking to replenish a deficiency of magnesium, say from extended oral contraceptive use or something like that, or if you take your blood work and you see a low RBC magnesium or red blood cell magnesium, or if you have a kidney dysfunction, IgA nephropathy or something like that, that decreases the amount of magnesium absorbable, then that's when you would choose a supplement, I think, because you have a specific outcome in mind, right? Chronic insomnia, cramping in the muscles and the legs, restless leg syndrome, that kind of thing. That's when I usually go for the supplement, in addition to adding in, the whole foods aspects. I don't know if that answers your question totally, but there's a cost benefit in my mind. Do you have something to add?
For the turmeric, I generally suggest the powder or the fresh root, but it's a little bit hard to know. But you can definitely add a pinch of black pepper to that to help with absorption.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And the fat.
And a fat.
So like a coconut, a little bit of coconut oil, or
some fatty food.
Coconut milk, or an avocado.
So have the juice, and then something fattier.
We can't give you advice. But if you're, so for example, like in cancer treatment, like if you're trying to treat cancer, then we would give an extract because it's extracted in an absorbable form, so that it can the curcuminoids. The active components can be better absorbed because it's compounded with the pepper prepared in extract. But that's for a specific purpose.
Mm-hmm. So you should do pepper and turmeric together?
Yeah, in the whole food form. Mm-hmm. You can get
anytime.
It helps.
Whole food, I think, at the store. So. Can I ask a question about calcium? Some people my age tend to have osteoarthritis. And some of you know that I have a thing now, that's why I'm walking the walker, because I have osteoarthritis in my body. I'm taking calcium, magnesium, and zinc.